By way of introduction, if you go online and check in the LinkedIn with Josh, what I loved about it was he kind of goes back to his job history when he was a busboy and a driver. And, you know, it wasn't too long that he was just like all of us in working through the aspects of getting through school and making it happen. I love that he found his passion. And what is really incredible that he's started a number of companies. Scale 8, I believe, was a real big start. And then Mosey. I remember driving down the freeway and seeing the advertisements for Mosey, and there were radio announcements. What he doesn't know is I applied for a job, but it took him about 45 seconds to say, I'm not quite qualified.
Sorry.
But the reality was I wasn't quite qualified. But it was one of those companies that you're saying, that is really cool, and they had a great thing going on. And so Josh is now the CEO of Instructure, leading a fantastic organization, and we are just excited to have him here. Technically, I mean, one of the brightest leaders in the community. Clint Betts was telling me how not only fun Josh is. If you saw his picture in the program, you know, he's got a fun personality and a good sense of humor. But it's great to have him here. So, Josh, I'm going to get out of the way and let you take over. Josh Coates, everyone.
I usually don't like being recorded because I can't be as candid, because maybe I'll run for office someday and then that'll ruin my chances. I'm just kidding. I'll never run for office. I have no interest in politics. Today, I'm going to talk about how to evaluate a startup idea. First, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. And then we'll just get into it, okay? Actually, before we do that, raise your hand if you are a software engineer. Like, some people are like, I'm sort of a software engineer, like three people. What if you're kind of a business person, involved in business somehow? Okay, a lot of business people. All right, and then what else is there? There's tech people and business people and that's it. Okay, the rest of you figure out which one. You'll pick one. All right, look, so this is me. This is a little bit of my resume. I've done a bunch of companies. I've done several startups. And this is where I get to brag about myself. So I've been in Wall Street Journal and Forbes. I went public on the New York Stock Exchange. Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year for Nationals. Tons of soccer trophies. If you're in business, you get a lot. You know, you walk into an office and they have awards, like little Lucite sort of. Is that what's called Lucite? Little plastic awards everywhere. If you have any kind of company that has even a tiny, tiny bit of success, you get those automatically. They're all fake, and so anyone says, "Look, I've got awards," just know that they're super fake. It's nice to get them, but they're all pretty much fake. I've even been on the cover of Utah Business magazine. That's kind of a big deal. So, anyway, so these are the jokes. I only have a few jokes. There's some jokes. Okay, so I think an important thing to understand is everything I'm going to talk about today is only applicable in a really tiny part of the universe of entrepreneurship. So if I tell you a bunch of stuff today and you're like, gee, I'm interested in opening a cupcake factory, cool, I don't know anything about that, and you just can ignore everything I told you today. But if you're interested in doing a high-tech startup, you know, that might have some venture backing, everything I'm talking about today is exactly applicable to what you're thinking about doing. So I just want to put that caveat out there, because I've got a lot of strong opinions. I've got a lot of scar tissue. I've been through a lot of stuff. And this is kind of what I know, but it's only in this context, okay? So it may not be applicable to your dreams. So here it is, how to evaluate a startup. You ready?
I'm about to do something, I think. Would an idiot do that? And if they would, I do not do that thing.
That's it. Okay, do you have any questions? Look, there's another one of those jokes. Okay, all right, so for real, by the way, that's excellent advice from Dwight. I think if more people thought, gee, would an idiot do this, and they didn't do it, their lives would be happier. Here, let me first talk about why your startup will probably fail, because this is about how to evaluate a startup idea. But I can assure you, your idea is probably not why you're going to fail, like picking a bad idea. A lot of people are super successful and they picked a bad idea. There's a lot of ways to work out of a bad idea. But the real reasons people fail are, this is a list of them. Your premise is bad, okay? So that's a little bit about what we're talking about, but really, you can't sell things. It's really, if you can't sell things, if you don't aren't a natural salesperson, and I know salespeople, everyone thinks a salesperson is kind of this cheesy, obnoxious person. That's all true, but you have to play that role as a CEO or a founder. It's just something you have to do. And if you're not good at it, chances are you won't be successful. You can't hire and fire people. You talk a lot, but you don't do anything. You're unwilling or unable to see things how they really are. A lot of reality distortion occurs in the world of business, and if you have a distorted view of the world around you, then it's going to be really difficult to succeed. And you won't admit or adapt to your own weaknesses. This is another huge problem. People fail at being introspective. Being successful as an entrepreneur requires, well, there's always exceptions to everything. All sorts of, you know, rotten, non-self-aware people are successful. But I think to be really successful, I think it's really important to be in touch with your own weaknesses and work on those. Okay, but these are for some other lecture series that you probably won't ever hear, at least not from me. We're going to talk about your startup idea, okay? So the first thing is when someone says, hey, I'm doing a startup, I want to tell you my idea, the response that you'll often get from anybody is, okay, what are you trying to do? And usually what they think the answer is they tell you their elevator pitch. I want to take a few steps back from that. This is a little bit more of the introspection that I referred to. You guys know Alice in Wonderland? You guys ever read that book? It's a good book. You should read it if you haven't read it. The sequel is pretty good too, Through the Looking Glass. I think it's Through the Looking Glass if you're into chess. Okay, this Cheshire Cat and Alice are talking. Would you tell me, please, which way I ought to go from here? Asks Alice. And then the cat says, that depends a good deal on where you want to get to. And she says, well, I don't much care where. And he says, well, then it doesn't matter which way you go. So when you're trying to figure out what you're trying to do, this is what I tell everybody. And if anyone's ever seen any lecture I've given, usually I try to sneak this in somewhere in the lecture, because I think if more people understood this concept, it would save them and their loved ones an enormous amount of grief. So I'll explain what this is. This is a depiction of a function, you know, like from algebra. You input X into the machine does its thing, and then it spits out Y, okay? Now we'll talk about what X is, what F of X is, and what Y is. But this is the most important concept that you'll hear from me today, okay? So, what is Y? Y is the output of this machine, okay? And that is what you get after you do your startup. Here, I'll cheat real quick. X is you, F of X is your little startup, and Y is what the startup does. And it's not like, hey, my startup builds, you know, new improved email servers. That's not what Y is, okay? Y is what you personally get out of this, all right? So let's talk a little bit about that. Why do you want to do a startup? Some people do startups for money. And a lot of times I'll talk to people and say, well, why do you want to do a startup? And they go, and they don't know the answer, okay? And sometimes in their head, their brain says, money, and they don't want to say that because they think it sounds bad. It doesn't. There's nothing wrong with wanting money, okay? It's just how you get that money is what matters. There's a lot of horrible ways to get money. There's a lot of noble ways to get money, and a lot of noble things to do once you have money. There's also a lot of awful, obnoxious things to do once you have money. But money itself, the desire to have financial independence, there's nothing wrong with that. So that's one of that's high on the list of why people want to do startups. Notoriety. Some people want to be important and want people to feel like they're important. especially nowadays. It's interesting. I have teenage kids, and my daughter said in class just the other day, her teacher said, everyone, I want you to have a fantasy about what you want out of life. What is, if you could make anything happen, what would you want to have happen? And she said an enormous percentage of the class said something about, gee, I just want 100,000 followers on my Instagram. And I'm not even kidding. I mean, of course, these are 17-year-old kids. But a lot of people, that's important to them, is to have people like them and think they're cool and think they're neat. And again, I don't think there's anything fundamentally evil with this desire. I think it's strange, and I think it's important you ask yourself why that's such an important need that you have. But it's a valid why in our equation. That's your goal. I want people to think I'm neat. Okay, great. Prove someone to someone that I'm good or smart or right about something. This is like, gee, my mom never loved me. And if I'm successful at doing a startup, maybe she'll love me. Again, this is deep sort of introspective psychology that we're talking about. But this is really, really important because a lot of people do a startup and they think their why is one thing, but actually it really is something completely different. And in fact, a startup will never give you what you want. So figure out what you want, okay? Make the world a better place. This is the cliche answer that you hear a lot of entrepreneurs say, and it's almost always a bunch of crap because your stupid startup isn't gonna make the world a better place. It just won't. If you really wanna make the world a better place, you should open an orphanage. Or you should go to Africa and figure out how to make clean water and live there. You should, I mean, there's so many ways to make the world a better place, but trust me, your tech startup almost definitely is not one of the ways to make the world a better place. And that's okay, it's totally okay. You can make the world a better place once you become, you know, a multimillionaire and you wanna go do something directly useful to make the world a better place. In the meantime, just, you know, make your startup work. So, but again, there are exceptions to all rules. It's just, I'd love to hear if you have an exception because I don't really know of any. Okay, and again, is there a better way to achieve the goal? If you do this exercise and figure out what do I really want, if, you know, you just really want to pay off your student loans and, you know, pay off your car and have a really good solid job, don't do a startup. That's a terrible way to get that done. Go get a real job, and you should be able to do that in a few years. Okay, now we're gonna talk about X. This is Y, all right? We're gonna talk about X here now, because X is all you got to input, right? There's nothing else. The only way to get Y is X and then some formula. So, what is X? Usually, you're one of these kind of people. These are buckets, right? And you say, no, I'm so much more than one of these things. No, you're not, right? Not to your investors, not to your customers, not to your potential employees. They will put you in a bucket, and you just have to live with that. And you just pick, it's better to pick your bucket beforehand, right? Because otherwise, if you just show up and be like, oh, yeah, I'm like the founder, and they try to figure out, well, what kind of founder are you? Are you, if you're an idea guy, by the way, that's like the worst thing to be. That's a euphemism for useless person, okay? So try not to be the idea guy. But try to be something else, you know, and just embrace that and run with it, okay? But you're gonna fit into one of these buckets, and you should ask what you're an expert at. Being a generalist is a terrible curse. You really want to focus on something and be an expert at something. A lot of people just say, hey, I'm pretty good at most things. Don't do that. That's terrible. Pick something to specialize in, to get passionate about, so you're the go-to person for some weird niche. And it's okay if it's such a tiny niche, no one knows about it. That's a start, okay? But become an expert in something. Okay. Let's talk about F of X now. So this is a great book, Founders at Work. It's the only book I recommend. People say, hey, Josh, do you recommend a business book? I say, not really, they're mostly all useless. or should be reduced to small, short pamphlets. But this one is really good. Anyway, go to Amazon, buy it, read it. Again, if you're interested in tech startups, it's a great book to read. Okay, so the founder of PayPal, originally his idea was to take little Palm Pilots. You guys remember what Palm Pilots are? In the 90s, there were these little handheld doohickeys. And his idea was, wouldn't it be cool if I'm at lunch and we're splitting the bill and I pay for it, but my buddy owes me $5, if we could bust out our Palm Pilots and he could like zap me over $5. That would be so cool. And that was his startup idea, right? That was his brilliant plan. And ultimately, as you can see, it was stupid and no one cares. You just pull out $5 and give it to your friend. And he, of course, didn't do that as a startup. But what his startup turned into was it evolved into a fraud detection system. And then ultimately, it turned into PayPal. Again, f of x matters probably the least if you define x and y really well. And by the way, people are terrible at defining x because people aren't, they're really bad at self-assessment. So if you can have friends help you, don't ask your mom, right? She's like, oh, you're good at everything. You know, just really try to figure out what you're really good at on x. But people are terrible at self-assessment. But again, if you get x and y really nailed down, it's actually almost trivially easy to come up with an f of x. It really is. I know that sounds counterintuitive maybe or surprising, but it's really easy to come up with an f of x if you're perfectly honest about your x and your y. Okay, so we're going to keep talking a little more about f of x. In fact, this whole thing's about f of x the rest of the lecture here. So there's two big choices when you're trying to decide what to do for a startup. One is invent some new weird thing and hope everyone loves it, okay? There's like Twitter. It's like, what's Twitter? Oh, I got this cool idea. It's like, you know, 140 characters and you put it on a website and cool, huh? And everyone's like, I've never heard of that. That's weird and stupid. But people really love it. And it's really changed the internet. So good for the Twitter guys, right? Usually these ideas train wreck though, because they're usually too weird or too stupid and people don't get into it and it just, nothing happens. But every once in a while there's a massive hit, right? And most often they're B2C, okay? That's business to consumer, right? So. Okay, or you can redo something that's due for a retread. So Google's a great example, right? Google was like the 17th search engine, right? It's like, oh, search engines, they all kind of suck. Let's do a better one. Or Blogger, right? Blogger is basically a new version of GeoCities, you know, which was a new version of Usenet. I mean, like, there's you can go back in history and see these retreads every 5 to 10 years. Like, here's an example, Slack. You guys know, who knows what Slack is, right? Lots of people know it's worth, you know, over $1 billion. It's a chat tool. I mean, those have been done, like, I don't know how many times. But what did he do differently? Oh, it's a new chat tool. Okay, great, cool. We need a new chat tool. I use Slack, I think it's great. Because what I used before, you know, wasn't as good. I used IRC before, and it's kind of clunky and crappy, but Slack is shiny and easy to use. Great. So these are the kind of the two big categories. You can either invent something new and probably fail, or you can pick something that's broken and just redo it, and you'll have a better chance of succeeding. But again, these are just kind of general rules. Let's go back to our F of X. So, you know, when I've done a few startups, and the first one I did, Scale 8, that was my background. So I went to Berkeley, I studied large-scale parallel data systems, and I focused on, it's a type of supercomputing that was kind of cool and new in the 90s. And when I got into industry, I focused on data storage, massive data storage using parallel systems and distributed architecture. And Scale 8, I was like, oh, hey, I know, let's take data storage, and we didn't call it this at the time, but you know, let's make cloud storage. Okay, cloud storage, people know what that is now, but 15, 17, 18 years ago, no one knew what it was. And so I was trying to invent a market. And not surprisingly, it didn't work, because it's really hard to invent a new market. And so that was a big train wreck. We raised $60-70 million in venture capital and went through a bunch of CEOs, and it was awful. So then after that was over, I thought, oh, you know what? I think, you know, because I didn't do the whole X, Y, F of X thing with Scale 8. I just kind of said, oh, everyone's doing startups, I should do a startup. So, but the second time around, I'm like, okay, all I really want is $7 million in my checking account. Like, that's all I really want. So how do I do that? So I just work backwards from there and basically derive this simple X, Y, F of X sort of paradigm. It seemed like it was pretty simple. I'm like, well, I know data storage. I know how to, you know, write this kind of software. I have some experience in this, and $7 million and me and what's in between those two things. And so I did an online backup company, and it was very focused. But the way I chose the online backup company, which was, again, a retread. I didn't invent online backup. It's just all the backup companies really sucked. And so it was really easy to do a way better one, and it all worked out. But I actually made a spreadsheet. I got out Excel, and I made a list of attributes. Ease of implementation, revenue potential, minimal capital required, competitive landscape, IPO potential, acquisition target, market size, fundable, and fun and interesting. So I'll go through each of these. But I basically said, you know what, my F of X, I should evaluate it, my different startup ideas, based on these. Okay? Because some idea I might have might be a tiny market size. It might have tiny revenue potential, but it's super easy to implement. I probably shouldn't do that one. Or I might have something that's really high in everything, but it's like, you know, cold fusion level to implement. It's like, oh crap, I can't do that. You know, so I this is what I did. It was a very simple, boneheaded process. And in my mind, doing simple, boneheaded processes are the way to be successful. I'm relatively simple-minded in how I think, and so this is how I did it. I just made a spreadsheet, and then I kind of graphed it, and the startup idea that had the highest bars, I'm like, okay, I'll do that one, and it worked out that way. I mean, obviously you put a little more thought into it, but it really was a simple spreadsheet. So let's go through each of these. We've only got about, well, we don't have much time, so I'll try to go quickly here. Ease of implementation. So easy, hard. So easy, look, yet another nearly identical 3D modeling sharing site. Yay. So that's throwing a website together is pretty simple. On the other hand, doing like kernel level development on the latest Windows release and having it backwards compatible for the last half dozen versions of Windows, that's nightmarishly complex. Okay? Your startup idea is either going to be on the left or the right or somewhere in the middle, but this is something to consider. How hard is this to actually do? And seeing as how most of you are non-tech people, you have no idea at all how hard something is. So that's a serious disadvantage, and most likely none of you are going to be successful at any of this, because mostly business people aren't. If you actually make a list of all successful tech companies, almost none of them were founded by business people. So I know that's really depressing to hear, but I'm not here to make you feel good. I'm here to teach. So learn that. something you can do about it, though, is either switch your major into something more useful, or just become really good friends with some tech dude, like at Apple. Well, actually, both of those guys were tech dudes. It's just that Steve Jobs wasn't quite as nerdy as Wozniak was, but they both coded. They were both engineers. So try to come up with another example of a business person that's been successful with a tech guy. I know there's some out there. They're just not as common. Not as common. But yes, find your Wozniak or whoever, and then try not to be like a total butthead, exploitive business person like tech people think you all are. So that's maybe too much candor. Okay, all right. So let's talk about revenue potential. So your idea, someone's got to pay you for it. On sort of the hierarchy of needs, oxygen is, everyone needs oxygen or they die. So that's the most important thing. Next after that is water, and then food. And then somewhere on this end of the spectrum is modern art. So your good or service will fall somewhere on this spectrum. Obviously you want it more on the left side than the right side. I know this seems stupid, but a lot of really crappy startup ideas are stupid and crappy because they're really esoteric and not terribly important. So this is just something to consider. How much revenue can I actually get for my idea? Minimal capital required. So some people have brilliant ideas. Hey, wouldn't it be cool? We'll build spaceships and we'll go mine asteroids. And yeah, it's only going to be $170 billion to do that. You know, so you can come up with cool ideas, but they're really expensive. And then some ideas are cheap, right? Oh, let's throw a website together. Super stupid, cheap, you know, like Pinterest, right? I mean, holy crap. It's like, here's a website with pretty pictures. The end. Oh, you have a pretty picture? Send us the URL. We'll copy it onto our website with pretty pictures. That's the whole, I mean, that's it. I mean, some guy probably coded that up in a weekend, right? And now they're worth a ton of money and they provide a wonderful service to many, many people. Good job, Pinterest, awesome. But who are we kidding? Pretty cheap to implement that technology, right? And on the other hand, you have like, oh, we're gonna make a new vector processor for the next, supercomputing mobile device. That's over in the, oh my gosh, do you have a chip fab somewhere, right? And then there's everything in between, okay? A lot of super awesome startup ideas are on the left and on the right. And if you happen to, have a vision and passion and drive for something that's a little more on the right, go for it. But just watch out for the guys on the left, because some people can really screw you up with not a whole lot of money. So things to be aware of. Okay, next, competitive landscape. So if you come up with some cool startup idea, just put a little matrix like this together. Pick a Y value and an X value. I kind of overloaded those terms. These aren't the X and Ys that we talked about before, but something like speed and cost, or ease of use and feature set. You know, something in your marketplace that, where your startup lives. Pick a couple of values that you think are important, and then hopefully you end up in the upper right-hand quadrant and all your competitors are everywhere else, right? So just put something like this together and help you think through, gosh, are we really competitive? What is our serious competitive advantage? And rule of thumb, you want to be, I mean, the best thing to do is say, hey, we're 10x better at something, right? If you have a 10x, if you're 10x better, really good chance you're going to be super successful, all things being equal. If you're like, we're 30% better, no one gives a crap, right? So that's just, again, rule of thumb. If your thing's only a little bit better, no one will care. So this is a great way to reality check how competitive your idea is. Okay, IPO potential or an acquisition target. So this is where you make money, right? You don't make money from your salary. In fact, if you do a startup, lots of people don't even take salaries, at least initially, and then sometimes they take one later on. You make money from the value of the equity in your company. Is someone buying you out or going public? Going public is very rare. Getting bought out is more common. Well, the most common thing is you just crash and burn and it doesn't work out. But if it is successful, you get bought out. So you should think at the beginning, before you invest any real capital or energy into it, think, gosh, would anyone, can I envision who would buy this thing? Like who would buy my company? which other company would buy us? Why would they buy us? Could this ever go public? Because maybe you don't want to go public. Maybe you don't want to go public. But you know what? Someone who buys you, if you are able to go public, that might be really interesting to them. Someone who invests in you, if you're able to potentially go public, maybe that's exciting to them. So that's an important thing to consider, even if you don't want to go public, is think to yourself, is there any other company on the NASDAQ that does something like this? And the answer is no, there's none. Chances are, you know, your idea is not something that is, you know, able to go public ever. And it's probably something else. Either acquisition bait, or maybe it's just a crappy idea. Okay, let's talk about market size. This is kind of a funny example, because it has nothing to do with technology, really, or at least not high tech. Does anyone know what that is? It's coal? No, it's oil shale. It's close. It's like coal's cousin. Coal's less valuable cousin. Okay, so you can take a ton of shale, oil shale, and you can take a ton of it and get one barrel of oil out of it through lots of different types of processes. You can take tires, and a ton of tires will give you 3 barrels of oil. Wow, look, there's an opportunity. Wow, a 3x advantage. That's, you know, that's not a 10x, but 3x is pretty good. Okay, it turns out there's 2 trillion tons of oil shale. Okay, and there's only 3 million tons of tires every year that are discarded. Okay, so let's do some real quick math. By the way, the U.S. consumes 20 million barrels a day. Okay, so if we have 3 million tons per year and there's 3 barrels, that's 9 million barrels times, say, $50 a barrel. So $450 million of potential revenue if you got every spare tire ever. So that's a pretty tiny market, right? No one's going to give you $50 or $100 million to go tackle a $400 million market that there's no way you're going to monopolize. Okay, but 2 trillion tons, 2 trillion barrels times $50 barrels, that's $100 trillion. That's a good market. Right? You could only own a tiny percentage of that and be really happy. So anyway, this is why this doesn't exist, right? This is why we don't take spare tires, old tires, and make oil out of them. No one really does that. Very few people do that. Why? It's because the market's tiny, even if you come up with a cool technology to do this. So your idea, you have to ask yourself, how big is this market? And if it's less than $1 billion, chances are no one gives a crap about it, and you shouldn't either, if you want to be in the venture tech business, okay? If you want to be in some other business, hey, maybe that's great. But this is how this one works. Okay, let's talk about whether it's fundable or not. Your idea is fundable. Okay, this is the Gartner hype curve. You can Google that. You basically, something neat happens with technology. There's what's called the peak of inflated expectations. Everyone's like, oh my gosh, this is the greatest thing ever. There's the trough of disillusionment when everyone's like, oh no, just kidding, it sucks. And then the slope of enlightenment, well, it's okay, right? And then the plateau of productivity. So all your investors, potential investors, are all a bunch of sheep, and they just follow this curve, okay? So if you're gonna get funded, it's gotta be at that point in the hype curve or at this point. If it's anywhere in between, they're not gonna give you money for your stupid idea. They just won't. If your idea is stupid and it's there or there, yeah, they might give you money, okay? So is it fundable? This is another thing to consider. And finally, is it fun or interesting? Well, this is a graph where you have stimulation on the y-axis and financial compensation on the x-axis. You've got ditch digging, which is not stimulating or lucrative. You've got research, which might be very interesting, but no one really pays you much because, you know, that's researchers don't make much. Soul-sucking golden handcuffs, right? You can make a ton of money doing mindless, horrible work. And then, of course, you have your Uber job. So evaluate your startup versus this. I mean, maybe when you think about it, you're like, wow, the startup idea I have actually won't be very fulfilling. Maybe there's something else that will be. So, okay, so that's the summary here. X, Y, F of X. And just a reminder, even though this is really important, these are the reasons why your stuff won't work for Reels, okay? But, the F of X idea is still really important. Let me blow through really quick a lecture series. By the way, the lecture series, I've seen the schedule. You've got great speakers. They all have really cool experience and background. Very valuable. I mean, really amazing. So if you're serious about this, I would attend every single one. It's really awesome. This lecture series I'm about to share with you is probably a lecture series I would do, but I'm not going to. But I just want to give you a hint of what's in store for you if you decide to be a venture-backed startup entrepreneur. Ready? Okay. I'll just read them really fast, and then we'll go to Q&A. Why venture capitalists are useful bastards. Yes, your business degree is pretty much useless. Why your lack of self-awareness is making you fail. Why the corporate structure you picked was stupid. How bootstrapping your startup is sometimes dumb. Lecture number 7, I think. How your fear of firing people will wreck your company. Patents, almost always a complete waste of time and money. Why investors laugh at your absurdly naive financial projections. Learning that your startup is not your baby and how to get over it. Why hero worshiping rich, successful entrepreneurs is stupid. Why your 20-page business model is nearly useless and no one cares. How to completely screw up your cap table before you even raise a Series A. Unfortunately, your mentor probably hasn't actually been there or done that. How to become a cliche. You're the toxic founder of your own successful company. And why your friend's uncle, the attorney, can't be involved in incorporating your sweet new startup. I wish I had this Elixir series when I was in my 20s, starting out. I really do. There you go. Okay, who's seen Silicon Valley? HBO Silicon Valley. Okay, this is about as close to real life as you get. I'm not even kidding. If you want to know what it's like doing a venture-backed startup, just watch this series. I can't really watch it because I've got PTSD, and it's even though it's hysterical, it's painful to watch because it's so real. It really is. Also, let me recommend CB Insights. Just Google CB Insights. It's a small firm, does research in the tech world. Really great stuff, really good stuff. I have no affiliation with any of this stuff, but I just thought I'd share it. Also, PM Archive, this is Mark Andreessen's old blog. He wrote a bunch of essays about startups. Super awesome. They're still available at this website. It's the archive. Really good essays. And then also, Venture Hacks. These guys actually know what they're talking about. Most of the crap you see online is just a bunch of bull. Like, it's written by people that actually have never done startups. Most often you hear how to raise money by people who have never raised money. Anyway, this is good stuff, Venture Hacks. And that's it. That's the end of the show. So now we've got about 10 minutes for questions, 5, 7, 8 minutes. We have some number of minutes for questions.
Since we're recorded, we like to get microphones. So raise your hands fast and ask good questions.
So you said when you're looking to start a business, to look at other businesses that you can kind of see what they're worth. So what business did you look at when you were starting Instructure?
Well, Instructure, Blackboard was a publicly traded company at the time. They were the leader in the learning management system space. They were worth about, I don't know, $1 billion, $1.5 billion. I thought, well, that's a good amount of money. Let's go do that. So that's it. That was your question, right? That answered your question? All right, simple question. Okay. Yes.
So you said on patents always a complete waste of time and money. Can you expound on that?
Sure. In the tech world, I think I use the term almost always. They are almost always a complete waste of time. Startups, in the tech world, most of your patents are software related, and software patents are super easy to work around. Patents cost, between $20,000 and $50,000 each to actually go through and take an enormous amount of time and energy. And by the time you're done, and even have a preliminary patent granted, no one cares. Whatever your patent is, I am certain I can come up with some way to work around it and still accomplish the same thing. So you're totally wasting your time. Maybe you're trying to impress investors. A long time now, investors are a little more sophisticated nowadays, but you know, 10, 20 years ago, they were like, oh, patents, that means you have, you know, defensible technology. Now most people know patents are crap. So if you're trying to impress someone and get patents, like I have several patents actually. That's when I was stupider than I am now. And they're useless. They're neat on your resume, I guess. But no, they're not useful. If you're Hitachi or IBM, yeah, they have thousands of patents. And those are titans fighting off in the distance. That's not you, right? They use patents for very particular reasons that actually have nothing to do with protecting intellectual property. But that's a whole other lecture series. But yeah, so if you're working on a patent, stop. Again, in the context of high-tech venture-backed startups, your patent's probably dumb and a waste of time. You shouldn't do it. So, other questions?
No, I was going to ask the same thing. So
okay, well, was that a satisfactory answer?
It was, yes.
Okay, great. Other questions?
Address real quick. So your first real startup, you had a lot of challenges. What did you learn from that that made your next one much more successful?
How valuable?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think failure is super important, super duper important, and should be embraced. I learned so many things for my first startup. I don't even know where to begin. I can spend hours talking about what I learned. I learned raising too much venture capital can make you stupid. I've learned Harvard MBAs don't always know what they're talking about. old guys with gray hair that are rich most often don't know what they're talking about. I learned firing people is super important to get good at. I learned that it's easier to, like I talked about in this lecture, it's easier to go fix an existing market than try to invent a new one. I learned that most things you read in the press are inaccurate. This was before fake news was cool. News has always been fake, always. I don't know why people are just realizing that now. But yeah, I mean, I just learned so much. But yeah, it was something I'd never want to replace, all that failure. I cherish it, but yeah.
Yeah, so I have a combination of two questions.
Yes.
What are some of your recommendations when raising capital?
Yeah.
And then do you recommend raising capital? Because I know a lot of people don't. Like, they fear giving up too much equity.
Yeah.
Or outside investors are going to let their own interests take over yours.
Yeah, yeah. People that are scared to raise money are noobs and don't know what they're talking about. Raising capital is smart, and it's difficult. I can spend a whole lecture on how to raise venture capital. I think somewhere in the series you'll have a lecture on that. And it's given from a VC perspective, though. I don't know if that guy actually has raised venture capital before, but he's writing checks, so it's valuable to hear what he has to say. It's a lot like dating. You have to get someone to like you a lot. And you only have a couple of dates to do it. And that's what raising money is. And if you look right, and you say the right things, and you give off the right vibe, you become attractive. If other people are competing for your attention, you become even more attractive. If you say something stupid, like on your first date, hey, how many kids do you want? They're gonna be like, okay, weirdo, and they're not gonna give you a second date, right? I mean, like, I know it's all really silly sounding, but it is exactly parallel, raising money and dating. I've raised a ton of venture capital, lots, over the last 20 years, and been on a lot of dates, right, with the VCs. And it really is like that. So again, I could spend a lot of time talking about it, but it's the number one most important thing for a founder is to be able to raise venture capital. If you cannot raise funding, your startup's dead, and no one will want to come work for you, and you probably won't succeed. And if you borrow 150 grand from your rich uncle and 50 grand from your siblings, you're gonna probably burn it up and lose it, and then it's gonna be really awkward at family reunions. I've done that, right? I mean, everything I'm telling you that's stupid, I've done. right? And I've seen it done over and over again. Venture startups are like romantic comedies. Once you've seen like 50 romantic comedies, you've seen all of them, right? The first 10 minutes, you're like, oh, that's the good guy, that's the bad guy, she's gonna end up with that guy, but first some crazy stuff's gonna happen, watch. And then 2 hours later, ta-da, you were right. That's because they're all the same. Same with venture capital. Once you've been through it a bunch, it's all the same. So anyway, it's an unsatisfying answer, I apologize. But that, I mean, that's a big topic.
Last real quick question and then we'll
dismiss. Okay. You said you had some scar tissue and some PTSD.
Sure, yeah.
What is that from exactly, and how did you learn to deal with it?
Trauma, that's what that's from. So I don't know what else to tell you. I mean, you know, yeah, I've got war stories, right? I mean, it's, you know, you do layoffs, you get rejected, you know, you fire people twice your age. You feel like a fraud. You lose, you know, millions of dollars of investors' money. You get lied to, you get cheated. It's just a nightmare, right? Go watch Silicon Valley, that funny TV show. By the way, it's a little crude. So if profanity offends you, you'll be offended. Watch that and you'll watch trauma happening and you'll say, oh, that's so silly, that they must exaggerate. No, it's horrible how real it is. But yeah, watch that, you'll get an idea of how you develop scar tissue and PTSD. So.
Okay, let's hear it for Josh. Okay.